Thank you, Inga. Thank you, Felix. Fantastic opportunity. More than anything else, huge education for me. And these are my disclosures. I don't know how I've gotten a score of 9. I'm not so sure how it happened. Maybe I've made a mistake, but anyways. So the questions here are, is there a widely agreed upon definition? Before we talk about something on a global scale, we should all be sure about what we are talking about. So is there a widely agreed upon definition? And then, of course, the second question is there a minimum standard of care for all forms of AV canal? I think it's worth asking that question. For some reason, the slides are moving faster than I can speak. I know why that's happening. I know why that's happening. I think it's because I've rehearsed once, so I'll exit show and do it again. All right. Okay. So the key question is there a widely agreed upon definition? And then, of course, I'm going to talk a little bit about what should be the standards of care. So the first question, we all kind of know what AV canal, unbalanced AV canal is. Even at the end of all this that we've gone through, we kind of know, but we can't put that as a clear definition for a global audience, I think. We still can't come up with a clear, simple, four-sentence, three-line definition that can be agreed upon by everybody. So I think that's a bit of a problem in that we don't, it's not easy to define, particularly in borderline situations. There's lots of room for ambiguity, and we've talked about these echo indices that have been used thus far, and I'm not going to go into those details again. There is AV valve index, the inflow angle, and others which determined by ventricular volumes. So the core issues with echo, really, when we talk about echo, a lot of papers get written on echo indices. You know, you have lots of papers, but not much gets translated into day-to-day practice. And that's because it's not easy to standardize views. The exact same view you have to take in every single patient. The gains have to be, you know, adjusted in a very uniform way. The color flow signals have to be having the right kind of scales. So it becomes very hard to then have a very reproducible standard. Then you need to have inter and intra-observer agreement to be tested. And then finally, you need prospective validation with very good, robust outcome measures. So that's very hard. There is no consensus. What we have is AV valve index, and this index probably makes the most intuitive sense. There is very good retrospective validation with the CHHS database and that paper that was quoted, 300 plus patients, but there is a need for prospective multi-institutional studies. And this is the data that was shown earlier, but essentially to point out once again, that it's in this subset where there is AV valve index of less than 0.4, that the results are most horrible, both with biventricular as well as univentricular repair in terms of mortality. So this particular subset is challenging to define, to manage, to have come up with a uniform plan. Assuming there are criteria that we all agree upon, so let's just assume that we understood what it is. We have to ask the next question, what should be the standard surgical approach? And you've heard these approaches from our speakers, biventricular repair, staged biventricular repair, 1.5 ventricular repair, and univentricular. You also understood that there is really no consensus. There is very clear lack of uniformity. There's also general contentious issues. And yesterday, these contentious issues emerged in AV canal repair. I think all of us understood that there isn't a universal agreement on age at initial repair, and there is some controversy. There's even something that is thought to be pretty straightforward, like cleft closure. There does seem to be some disagreement. And then, of course, two-patch versus single-patch versus modified single-patch, there is a lot of disagreement again. I think it underscores what Pedro was mentioning, that surgeons base themselves on what they see more than anything else. It's their experience first, and then experience of a respected colleague whom they respect, and collective experience from literature, which seems to have the least value. So what we discuss, what one surgeon wants to do, is often not easily agreed upon, or, you know, it's not something that somebody else will start doing overnight. So there is very wide you know, the problem really lies in prescribing a minimal global standard for unbalanced AV canal, because there's just tremendous variability. The maximum variability is in lesions. There's variability in physiology, comorbidities, and in surgical skills and institutional capabilities. So if you just take AV canal across the board, the anatomy, it's, you know, complete, partial, or intermediate. Then you have Rastelli classification. Then you have the mural leaflet, which could be adequate, absent, or deficient. It could be papillary muscles, which could be single, two closely separate, closely spaced papillary muscles, straddling, left AV valve, and so on and so forth. You just have a whole range of possibilities, apart from, of course, being balanced and unbalanced. And in fact, each influences the other. So if you take an unbalanced AV canal, a subtly unbalanced AV canal, and to that you add the issue of a single papillary muscle, or you add a situation where the AV valve is leaking big time, then it becomes much more complex. So there is just an extraordinary level of complexity here. I think this quote summarizes it beautifully. I think every case is unique. And the most important thing is that you have to let the valve tell you the anatomy. That's what the surgeon says, and not try to fit the anatomy into some textbook picture. It's true for a whole lot of surgical situations, but particularly true for AV canal. This is something that you don't see very often in this part of the world, but in my part of the world, this is something we deal with every day. So there's a whole range of possibilities with pulmonary vascular resistance. Starting on the left, this X-ray shows increased pulmonary blood flow. On the extreme right is an X-ray that shows Eisenmengerization. And somewhere in between is a borderline situation. We are not sure what's happening. And we deal with this on a daily basis. There's, of course, physiologic variations resulting from AV valve leak, ventricular functions, and associated lesions that are particularly common. Issues relating to patient comorbidity, apart from Down syndrome, in my part of the world and in much of the low and middle income countries, is nutritional status, which is a very big player. Lung infections, it's very rare to come across a left to right shunt in a child who has not had a pneumonia. So that's another very significant issue. And then of course there are other syndromes and other issues. This is something you take for granted in the Western world, is that that's with institutional capabilities, which is essentially, you assume that you have all the components of pediatric cardiac care in your institution. And you sort of think that that's a given, but that's not the case in almost 90% of world's institutions. For example, in my own institution, we don't have a dedicated intensivist. We have an anesthetist who's also an intensivist. And some of the intensive care is delivered by myself and my team members. So there is a lot of, you know, real-world problems as far as staffing and institutional capabilities are concerned. But the real thing that matter is surgical waiting lists. And if you have a very large surgical waiting list, your threshold to do a difficult case would be different. A demand on ICU beds. It's important to remember that many, many institutions in the world do not have a dedicated pediatric TE probe. Support systems for long ICU stays. So somebody starts to stay more than a week, it's a tremendous drain on resources, and it's very difficult for these patients to be managed. And I think this is another factor. If you are familiar and comfortable with the univentricular pathway with hypoplastic left heart syndrome, your threshold would be different for managing two ventricle versus single ventricle. So if you're used to doing hypoplast, then you would put them down the single ventricle pathway a little more easily. But on the other hand, two ventricle pathway requires ECMO sometimes. And if you have a borderline case and you don't have ECMO, that could be another issue. So there is a whole lot of factors that influence institutional capabilities. Well, the ground realities with surgery is that this is a difficult operation. You ask most surgeons, trainees particularly, they'll say it's difficult. There's a lot of judgment, finesse, craft. There's a really long learning curve. And it's really for the most accomplished congenital heart surgeon. As Dr. Mohanty said, it separates the average congenital heart surgeon from the good congenital heart surgeon. So there are some nice quotes here. Again, this is from Dr. Ohai, who's really supposedly a very, very accomplished surgeon. But he made the statement that it's not something that you would share with trainees. To put it more simply, most surgeons are afraid to give AV septal defect surgeries to their trainees. And there's another one from David Winlaw who says that, I would observe, no names, that some people never do a good AV canal repair, let alone the unbalanced ones, but some have a knack for it, like Dr. Bizard. So, you know, it's something that you kind of develop a skill for it, and it's very difficult to quantify. Having said all this, let's confront some real-world realities as far as congenital heart surgery in general is concerned. Let's look at the situation of the average child in the world. And I think this is a very important graph which shows the global human development indices, and all those countries that are in dark blue are the blessed ones, where I think every child will have access to a good AV canal surgeon. But everywhere else, it's going to be some variability, and somewhere, particularly Africa, there's just no surgery at all. So if you actually look at this map, you don't get the true picture. You get the true picture when you see this one, because it expands the population of those parts of the world where there is a real problem as far as human development is concerned, and it's there that you don't have access to surgery. So, you know, I think Nicholas mentioned a single surgery center in India that does 1,000 surgeries. That's simply not enough. We are tackling about 7% of our national surgical requirement as far as infant heart surgery is concerned. So there is a tremendous deficiency globally as far as congenital heart surgery is concerned. And it's not entirely distributed on geographic lines. If you take large cities in India, for example, or anywhere, any large metro in the world, take Rio or take any large city, Shanghai, essentially, they're all microcosms of the globalized world in the sense that all the cardiovascular tertiary healthcare professionals, good surgeons, have all gone to those parts of the country that are essentially having the affluent populations. So the rural poor, the urban poor, they have nobody. So the vast majority, and I put it very simply, if you look at the global economic pyramid, the vast majority of the world's population have no access to heart surgery. And then if you climb up that pyramid, you'll have some who have access to pediatric heart surgery. And believe me, there's such a difference between the two. And it's, again, when you make the next grade, that's infant heart surgery, it's a quantum leap as far as resources are concerned. And then from on to infant heart surgery, you want to do AV canals. That is another quantum leap, because not every infant heart surgeon can do AV canals. Then you talk about complex canals. It becomes an extreme rarity. I think, just to put it very simply, from the perspective of an average family of an infant with an AV canal from a low and middle income country, the finding a capable heart surgeon is equivalent to winning a lottery. So that's the reality. So having said this, I mean, I don't want to necessarily present a very depressing perspective. There is a lot of work that has happened, and that's reflected in the International Quality Improvement Collaborative that I'm a part of. And we do have a very large collective database from low and middle income countries. The participating centers in 2015, there were 39 globally. And these were the countries they were located in. If you can see that, it's in South America, it's in India, China, in Russia. Unfortunately, Africa has just got nothing. And it's just one center in Uganda. But essentially, this is the true, you know, where the large volumes of population, where you saw the bulge in the world population graph that I showed you. So these are the number of centers, and there were, in this particular period, between 2010 to 2014, we had 30,000 surgeries. Currently, there are about 50,000 surgeries in this registry. It's an extraordinary registry that's being run by the Boston Children's Hospital. And we've got some very good data. The data isn't comprehensive, but it's got some key elements. It captures some very important key elements that tell us a very important message. I looked at the biventricular repair for AV canal in the IQIC database. And again, it's very interesting what you see. This was the period. This was when it was available. We had nearly 400 patients. And this represented 2.7%. I'm only looking at infants. It's about 2.5% of all infant operations. All but one were more than 30 days of age. So nobody attempted, practically speaking, any newborns. Look at the proportion of undernutrition. Weight under the fifth percentile, more than 3/4. 50% downs, like anywhere else. In-hospital mortality is depressing. So we had a figure of 3% quoted for AV canal from Europe and from a good collective database in an advanced country. But here it's 13% for 30-day mortality. And it's just reflecting the ground realities of these centers, mind you, that are better off in the low and middle income countries. The surgical site infection was 2.3%, bacterial sepsis, which is a huge problem, nearly 10%. Median ICU stay was long, and it matters in terms of resources, about 140 hours for this particular subset of patients. So this is balanced AV canals. When we talk about unbalanced AV canals, it was hard actually to figure out how many of these were balanced, but likely majority was balanced. So we had to go to the univentricular repair database to figure out how many were unbalanced AV canals, and there were 71 that were put down the univentricular pathway. And the mortality in this are indicated in brackets, 20% mortality, and various categories are shown where mortality is indicated in brackets in various subsets, and it's very high. VT shunt has a very high mortality in this particular subset. And balanced AV canal, you know, 26 balanced AV canals were subjected to a single ventricle pathway, and that's perhaps those categories that Pedro was mentioning, where you have a complex DORV or heterotaxy in addition, that's difficult for that particular surgeon to fix, 26% mortality. So why univentricular repair when there are two ventricles? I think this, in IQIC data, it is quite depressing that we have 33% of patients who were actually capable candidates for two ventricle repair that were subject to single ventricle repair. And the possible reasons, and this is from my experience, conduits are not easy to wear, not readily available, and we often say can't do it for conduit. And long ICU stay, borderline LV, which is unrealistic. You have a borderline LV, you have a very tight ICU situation, you may not want to do a two ventricle pathway. You don't have ECMO. And then you have genuine limitations in surgical expertise. You have overburdened surgeons. You have non-availability of CMR expertise, particularly for older patients when you want to actually try and determine what the exact volumes are. So these are all real-world limitations, so you end up going down the easy pathway. So I also did something beyond the IQIC, which I thought was very interesting because I thought that not all surgical centers were represented. I decided to do an internet survey for this particular talk. I took 15 accomplished surgeons who like doing AV canal repair, and I thought I'll pick their minds. They were in India, Malaysia, USA, and Australia. So I asked these questions. What youngest age do you feel comfortable with operating on AV canal? Both balanced as well as unbalanced, and the balanced ones were around 3 months. And, well, 12 out of 15 said they would do younger if pushed, but one was clear he wanted it more than 4 months, and two felt that age didn't matter. They could do even preemies. Unbalanced AV canals, well, 13 out of 15 said they would band if presenting early, but two said they would repair. And then I asked this question, which I thought was very important, because there was such ambiguity with echo criteria. And I asked this question, whether you use echo criteria to determine whether AV canal is balanced or how do you decide? And it was all subjective. 13 out of 15 surgeons said it's subjective completely. They didn't. One said they used the diameters of right and left component, and you know that that's going to be very hard. Nobody practically used the AV valve index. One said they used standard criteria but did not specify. Do you feel strongly about looking at echo images? That's the next question, and 13 out of 15 said yes, they would. And three wanted to be live when an echo is being done live. They wanted to be there watching it. Two were comfortable with the written report alone, provided it was done by somebody whom they could trust. Two patches or a modified single patch, and then we had some variety, and there were some very strong proponents of the Graham Nunn's technique, and they claimed fantastic results with that. And then I thought I would ask some general questions. What are the challenges? And why is this such a difficult operation? So there are many judgment calls, and that is whether you can do it now, you can actually fix it or not. Is it single versus two patch? Where to divide the patch? Where do we take the first stitch? How VSD patch dimensions? And this was all alluded to beautifully yesterday. How much should you close the cleft? Where should you put the coronary sinus? how much leak or stenosis can I accept after the repair? Again, it's a very tremendous judgment call because you don't know how that will progress. And then technical calls. I mean, I think this is a very difficult tissue handling at all stages. Skilled suturing, staying away from the crest of interventricular septum, avoiding leaflet distortion. And one surgeon said, this is a very interesting insight, avoiding air trapping in the aortic root while testing AV valve competence. So then this surgeon says that he learned how to put in a small vent in the aortic root at that point. So again, lots of insights emerged. I like this one quote that Prasad Krishnan, my former close friend and colleague, said, and that's handling tissue with respect, haptic feedback being very important. It's like a tiger that picks up its cubs by its neck without hurting them. I like this quote. I think it really reflects the kind of finesse that you need in handling the AV canal. It's something that maybe the great surgeons take it for granted. So to conclude, really, there's extraordinary variability. There are just numerous possibilities, and there are tremendous real-world challenges. So really, the answer to this question was no all along. What Felix had asked me, and I could have just said it in the first slide and not made this presentation. But I think it's been a worthwhile exercise. It's like a Zen koan. When you asked a very difficult question that doesn't have an answer, just searching for that answer gives you a lot of enlightening messages. And that's what has happened with me. So, I think just my final message really is that for myself as a cardiologist, I'd like to think like a surgeon. I'd like to share a comprehensive picture with the surgeon and immediately assess the results. You know, really, really focus very objectively on assessing the results, both immediate, intermediate, and short-term, and long-term as well. And that's just how we have to somehow find a way to translate years of collective experience into an intuition. That's something that's very difficult to put in words, but that's what makes practicing medicine so beautiful. Thank you.